On the face of the Gagliardi Trophy is the following statement, quote, honoring excellence in football, academics, and community service. Tonight, we are not here just to hand out a football award. We gather to honor a complete leader, both on and off the Division III football field. Michael Bates, Kevin Burke, Joe Callahan, and Dylan Jones are already big winners in life as they exemplify that leadership. Show, part of December's YD3 show, hosted by Dave McHugh and presented by the J Club, the City of Salem, the Old Dominion Athletic Conference, and D3Football.com. I'm Frank Rossi, and I'm joined by D3Football.com Executive Editor Patrick Coleman. And Pat, no matter who wins out of those four, there's going to be history made tonight. Obviously, the story of Kevin Burke, who could become the first repeat winner of the award. Joe Callahan could become the second junior to win the award, or we'll have representatives from Illinois College and Willamette University that have never had winners of the award in the 22 years of the award coming into tonight. So Pat, this could be interesting.
It sure could be. I mean, you know, we're talking about potentially Kevin Burke being the Archie Manning of Division III. I don't know if that's necessarily the comparison someone wants to make, but of course he's the two-time Heisman winner, and Kevin Burke could very well be the two-time Gagliardi Trophy winner. We'll find out here in less than an hour if that's the case. You know, he's a guy who had another fantastic season this year. His resume for the award doesn't change after having won it last year, so we certainly think that he's got a very strong chance to do it again this year. And for Joe Callahan, you know, you mentioned him. He's one of the a couple of juniors who were semifinalists, and the one junior who's a finalist. So if he has if he comes away with the victory, that'll be a history making as well. Michael Bates, you know, nobody from Illinois College has ever won this. Nobody from Willamette has ever won the Gagliardi Trophy either. So we are definitely looking forward to having a great night here in the Salem Civic Center.
Pat, let's talk about each of the four nominees, get a little deeper into each of their resumes coming into tonight. And we'll go alphabetically, showing no favoritism here. We'll start with Illinois College's Michael Bates, and he's had quite a season prolifically as a quarterback, the senior quarterback from the school of in Springfield, Illinois, three-time MWC first team selection, and this season over 3,000 yards, 32 touchdowns passing, all-time passing over 10,000 yards, 107 touchdowns, wow, and leads Division III in points responsible for 244 out of, I think, 394 total for his team. You can see his service right there. Talk a little bit about that player.
Yeah, Michael Bates is a guy who took over as a starting quarterback basically practically from the moment that he arrived on campus at Illinois College. Was a four-year starter, missed only a couple games because of injury, you know, helped lead this team to, you know, some heights that it hasn't had as a program. They were playing in the Midwest Conference Championship game. Hopefully we'll talk to Michael Bates about that too. But, you know, also look at that, look at the bottom lines, the academics and the community service. He's a 3.87 in biology with a chem minor. You know, those are not the sort of things that I would have gone to college to study. That was too much work for me.
And Michael Bates, first of four, we'll talk about here. Let's talk also about Kevin Burke. Again, we talked about the possible repeat winner, first time ever, for this award, the Archie Griffin of the Gagliardi Trophy, perhaps coming up here. Who knows? But he has a great resume too. Senior quarterback, 2013 winner, All North Regional Offensive Player of the Year, 43-1 record at Mount Union, and first quarterback to start three Stagg Bowls. Business administration, great GPA, and you can see again his community service. What kind of accolades can we bestow on him that we haven't already over the last couple of years?
Well, let's see. I think that he may not have been the D3Football.com Offensive Player of the Year yet. That could still change. You know, he's only brought home one Stagg Bowl so far. He's only got one walnut and bronze, one championship ring. But I tell you, I mean, this is just an electric player. You know, take a look at him. He's a guy who has led this team to exactly what they've done. You see Sherman Wilkinson there. He's comfortable in the pocket, but he's good to get out and run. He's got a lot of weapons to choose from. And if you haven't seen him, you will get to see him in the Stagg Bowl on Saturday night, or you can listen to it on D3Football.com also. Yeah, no, I don't think they run a lot of option, but they certainly could. He can run.
Wait a minute. Which option are we talking about here? But Kevin Burke, here as both player and a candidate for, or finalist for, the Gagliardi Trophy. Joe Callahan, Wesley College, and as a sophomore, he had some prolific numbers. As a junior, just as good, if not better, on that football field and as a leader as well. And, you know, you see, again, senior quarterback, all-South region first team selection, led Division III in passing, 4,190 yards, second to touchdowns, four or five touchdown games, and six versus Louisiana College, four times Dean's List or higher. I think he had a 4-0, at least one of those terms I remember reading.
Yes.
Major kinesiology. I practiced that a couple times in exercise science, 3.39. And again, some great service.
Did you practice kinesiology, or did you practice saying kinesiology?
Only saying it. I'm not really that adept at it.
Joe Callahan, you know, he's a guy who, you know, missed 2012 because of injury, came in 2013, took over as the starter. And, you know, the first thing he did straight out of the gate against Widener in his opening game was threw for a school record number of touchdowns. You know, they played a Division I FCS school here. You saw them against University of Charlotte. And they played a schedule that was literally and figuratively all over the map. And we'll talk to him about that in a little bit. But he's a guy, he's a pocket passer. But, you know, if you shake him out of the pocket, he does have the ability to hurt you with his legs a little bit. But, you know, and the other thing is, you know, he's the latest in a long line of standout quarterbacks at Wesley and has another year left after this one.
And the New Jersey Athletic Conference is thrilled to hear about that as they join that conference next season. But first things first, we'll see if he is the winner tonight of the Gagliardi Trophy. The final of the four finalists, he said, was Dylan Jones from Willamette University. And let's look at Dylan Jones, the only running back of the crew here. Northwest Conference Offensive Player of the Year, D3Football.com All-West Region First Team Selection. Nearly 1,600 yards this season. What's a yard between friends? 350 yards in a game. Leads Division III with 177.7 rushing yards per game. Environmental studies major and a lot of service behind his credentials as well. I think Dylan Jones and the Linfield game will become synonymous in a lot of ways because of his performance there, but he's been consistent all season long.
Yeah, and, you know, there's he's put up a lot of yards. As you mentioned, he was in the lead in Division III. You know, you can see him. He says, we talked to him earlier, and we'll talk to him on camera a little bit later, but you can kind of see what running back he likes to style himself after. And, you know, Willamette is a program that used to be known almost exclusively for running the ball. They ran what's called the fly, which is a lot of jet sweeps and that sort of thing. Now, last couple of years, a little bit more straightforward offense, and you can see a little bit more straightforward running, but you know, he's a guy who can get to the outside and he can cut back. And you don't put up those kind of numbers without having a lot of different ways to run, a lot of weapons in your running arsenal.
Rare to see a team that finishes 5-4 produce a finalist in the Gagliardi Trophy. That should speak volumes to the specialness of Dylan Jones. And we'll talk to his coach about that as well coming up. We'll talk to all four coaches of the finalists in the next couple of segments here and leading up to the dais and the activities up there. And Pat will have the honor of asking the candidates themselves some very pressing questions. Pat, you are a voter. You're an interviewer now of them up on the stage. It's got to be tough to come up with just a couple questions, a few questions to ask them because of the prolificness of their resumes through and through.
Yeah, it's really hard to boil down. I mean, you're asking a kid to boil down 3 or 4 years of college football and, you know, 12 years of a football career into about a 3 or 4 minute interview. But, you know, the nice thing about these you know, finalists for the Gagliardi Trophy, they're all well-rounded, right? We all know that they're well-rounded Division III athletes in terms of football, academics, and community service. So generally, they're also fairly good interviews, and we all know that they're all very smart people.
Pat, why don't we go to a break here and get our first couple coaches to discuss their finalists here. It is the 2014 Gagliardi Trophy presentation show. Stay tuned, folks.
Every season starts with hope and a dream to play for the ultimate title and to become NCAA national champions. And you can experience it live at the 2014 NCAA Division III Football Championship, December 19th in Salem, Virginia, hosted by the Old Dominion Athletic Conference and the City of Salem. Affordable tickets now available. Visit ncaa.com/tickets today and make a date with champions at the Amos Alonzo Stagg Bowl.
Division III allows you to be able to give yourself to other things, not even just participate in them, but really get involved with them if you want to.
There's a lot of interaction. It's not just sitting back, taking notes. you're actually doing hands-on things and better preparing yourself for your major.
Choosing a Division III school, I've had the opportunity to develop my leadership skills and to be more involved on campus.
Division III in athletics, you know, affords students the opportunity not only to participate in intercollegiate athletics at a competitive level, but also gives them the opportunity to, you know, engage in the other interests in their campus and in their lives outside of that sport and outside of the academics on the campus.
And to have opportunity to have time to join clubs and being able to play basketball, it allows you to just be able to do everything you want to do. I wouldn't change it for the world.
Every season starts with hope and a dream to play for the ultimate title and to become NCAA national champions. And you can experience it live at the 2014 NCAA Division III Football Championship, December 19th in Salem, Virginia, hosted by the Old Dominion Athletic Conference and the City of Salem. Affordable tickets now available. Visit ncaa.com/tickets today and make a date with champions at the Amos Alonzo Stagg Bowl.
And we're back here at the Gagliardi Trophy presentation show. I'm Frank Rossi, surrounded by two coaches right now. And we have Wesley head coach Mike Drass and Willamette head coach Glenn Fowles. And Coach Drass, let's talk about Joe Callahan first. An incredible season he's had. He was an incredible sophomore. And to really nominate a junior for this award, you have to have a lot of confidence in his leadership and maturity. Tell us what drove you and the college to nominate Joe as a junior this season.
Well, you hit on it right there. I mean, great experience, a great leader, and somebody who always, you know, thinks of his team first. You know, Joe's a young man who's driven to be as successful as he can be. But I tell you, I've never seen him once look at a stat sheet. You know, all he wants to do is help his team win. And, you know, it's a great honor, you know, to be here. And what a great event, and, you know, with four great young men.
Now, next year you lose a lot of experience on both sides of the ball. Your team joins the New Jersey Athletic Conference, which for you is probably a relief in terms of scheduling. We'll be talking to him about it, you know, going across the country in different games over the last couple of years especially. But for you, what importance does having Joe back play in becoming a national caliber powerhouse again next season?
Well, we do graduate 20 great seniors, but we also, you know, besides Seston Capapua, you know, every player we had rotated, you know, so we have a lot of guys coming back. Having Joe back, you know, as our leader and as that trigger man is going to be helpful to us, you know, one, from a recruiting standpoint, and two, you know, when we talk about competing, you know, he's going to be the guy who's going to be our leader and be the guy up front. And, you know, Joe is a very competitive young man, you know, and he wants to win and he wants his team to be successful. And, you know, I expect great things from next year, too.
Coach, we're going to go from east to west now with Coach Bowles from Willamette. Coach, you had an interesting season. There was some national exposure for you in a lot of fronts. Connor Mertens in the coming out story earlier on in the year, 2014. The win versus Linfield shocked the country. And now you have a Gagliardi Trophy finalist. Tell us kind of, you know, the ebbs and flows, especially coming up to tonight here. And, you know, work Dylan Jones into the story a little bit in terms of his leadership and maturity has helped things along the way.
Yeah, you know, and you're right. 2014 has been an interesting year for us from start to finish. And obviously, the highlight of that game against Linfield that that surprised everybody. But, you know, when you play conference rivals, it's something that you should never be surprised the outcome of. People get up for it, those sorts of things. And really, with Dylan, all year long, he's been a guy for us that has just been outstanding. Obviously, he's a quiet guy. And you're going to hear it a lot from all these coaches about how outstanding they are, what great leadership qualities they have, and they all deserve it. This is a fantastic award. And for Dylan, he's a quiet leader. He does more than he says, and it's one of those things that he has the ability to bring people up around him. And it's, you know, in the Linfield game in particular, he had a 98-yard rush from scrimmage that is a school record and really helped us in a lot of ways win that game. It's one where you have a guy that is that good.
You're kind of honing in on my next question, which is his three touchdown performance, but it was basically the game-winning score, the 98-yard run. You also gave him the ball the most times all season, for him 35 times. What gave you the confidence in him to put it on his back like that?
Well, it's one that
he's been doing it all year.
You know, he's been doing it all year. And in your biggest games, your best players have to perform. And he's one of the guys that can carry the ball. He's the guy that you can give the ball to and expect good things from it. I mean, he never fumbled at all year. And he was due to those guys great defense. You guys have watched him. They're outstanding. And Joe did a great job with those guys. But it's also one of those things that – And he's been performing like that all year. There wasn't a game that he didn't perform well. So he was our guy, and to beat a team like that, you have to get it to the guys.
Coach Bowles, Coach Strass, good luck tonight. Thanks for joining us as well. We'll be right back with two more head coaches to talk about two more finalists.
We've got more schools than Division I, more fans than Division II, and more upsets than March Madness. There's 800 programs with over 11,000 games leading to two national championships. And we've been covering it all for over a decade. From Eastern to Occidental, from Puget Sound to Piedmont, from Southwestern to the University of New England, and from Hope to Calvin. Nobody covers Division III basketball like we do. We're D3Hoops.com at www.d3hoops.com. We've got more schools than Division.
For the love of the game, that's what it's all about, they say. But for those of us who are Division III student athletes, it's more than that, a lot more.
Sure, the game is important, but as we work so hard to build both mind and body, it's more about team and the schools and communities we represent.
And for the many of us blessed with the strength to compete in sport at the college level, we understand that with what we were given comes a special obligation.
An obligation not merely to work towards a personal best in the classroom or in the sport we love, but rather an obligation to help those who have their own special needs and whose love for the game is no less intense.
That is why NCAA Division III teamed up with Special Olympics. For Special Olympics athletes, victory belongs not only to those who first cross the line, but to all those who compete and endure.
They are challenged in ways we cannot imagine. They are survivors who test themselves harder and with greater joy than we will ever know.
Since August of 2011, we and others from Division III campus communities have volunteered more than 250,000 hours, time away from the classroom and practice field, reaching across the country to coach and mentor Special Olympics athletes.
And to learn, as we all do, that in giving, we receive so much more in return.
Sport ennobles us. And in giving the gift of sport to those for whom it seemed an impossible dream, we are working to make this a better world.
Help us keep that dream alive.
Be part of it.
Get involved.
You can make a difference.
From Mount Union, and Coach Garrett Campbell from Illinois College joining me to talk about their finalists. Coach Karras, Kevin Burke, it seems like we've done this before, you and I at least here. And his numbers were very similar in 2014 compared to 2013 in terms of the number of touchdowns. The team has scored 158 more points in the first 14 games this season than they did in 2013. So I'd ask you to discuss Kevin's continued on-the-field maturation and, you know, what led to an upsurge of an already strong offense. Was he really a key part of that?
Well, absolutely. I think, you know, the quarterback position is
on any offensive unit, and having an experience at that position really is helpful to the offensive unit. And, you know, being that he's in his third year as a starter, and, you know, having started now 44 games for us, I think that really helps his decision making. And you know, we ask him to make a lot of decisions in our offense. You know, it's predicated on the zone read, and, you know, reading a defender to decide whether to hand the ball off or keep it yourself and run it or throw it out to one of the receivers. And you know, he does a great job with that. That's probably his strength as a quarterback.
Now, last year, your last visit here was not exactly the one you'd hoped for, and overall, there's a lot of learning to be done, I guess, in a loss. He hadn't lost a game as a starter, I think, since he was 13 years old, Kevin.
had not. What did he learn from that? What allowed you guys to get back here? Was that part of maybe his maturation, experiencing that loss last season and getting a taste to come back here?
Yeah, well, I mean, we had a great player in Kevin, but, in order to win the national championship, you have to have a great team, and you have to have a lot of depth and not have many weaknesses. And, you learn more about your team from a loss than a win, and, that's what we learned. We learned we needed to have better depth as a team. We needed to be able to play more men to contribute at a very high level to beat a team like Wisconsin Whitewater, and those are the areas we went about trying to fix. And Kevin did a great job of helping to nurture along other players to get them close to the speed that at which he plays the game and the quickness with which he makes decisions and gets the ball distributed.
Coach, good luck tonight with that.
Thank
and
you.
Good luck on Friday as well. Coach Campbell, we're going to talk a little bit about Michael Bates, and you had some quotes in your letter I want to refer to. First, you called him the most incredible man I have ever been associated with in the game of football. You're the son of a coach. The importance of him and his leadership this year, could you talk about it?
Yeah, it's not just this year. It's actually a culmination of his time in our football program and watching him grow as a person and as a man, and making sure that, he's just doing the little things he does along the way that really allow our program to rise up to another level. It's absolutely incredible. I mean, he's the most consistent human being I've ever been around in terms of his own personal grace of how he deals with situations, whether it's on the field or off the field. And I think that's really what separates him.
There's another paragraph here, and you quote "If" by Rudyard Kipling, where he describes what he hopes his son will be someday. And you take the quote, "If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings, nor lose the common touch," and you associate that with him. I wanted you to expound on that a little bit for folks so they can understand the nature of him off the field as well.
Right. So in my interactions with Michael, and we've had obviously – we've had him over to our house for dinner. We've been around him for quite a long time. I've just seen him in situations where it doesn't matter if he's with the president of the college or if he's sitting with a freshman who's struggling because maybe he's homesick. He doesn't, his level of grace and the person that he is does not change. He is who he is, and he's true to himself all the time. And I have been absolutely impressed on and off the field with that. And you can't, that's not something you can teach. That is something that somebody is, and it speaks to his character.
Again, Coach Campbell, Coach Karras, good luck to you tonight, and thank you for joining us. We're getting ready to go to the dais, but first we're going to take a quick break here, so come back to the Gagliardi Trophy presentation show.
I know sports is important, but having the academic part along with it is a big plus. I've discovered in myself, a newfound ability to overcome adversity at all different angles.
At a Division III school is really shaped around you developing yourself as a complete individual. The end result, in my mind, is you just become a very well-rounded person.
Before I came into college, I didn't really think I'd be able to balance so much. It helps a lot that you have a family with your team that can guide you.
With a D3 school, there's a lot of time for other opportunities. The coaches expect a lot of you during soccer, but after soccer, that's your own personal time to really find out who you are.
So it's kind of the steps to the Gagliardi Trophy and getting nominated, voting, let's say, guidelines for the voters out there. I believe 41 votes total actually exist, the fan vote being the 41st. Number one, schools, including the college president, nominate their most worthy student athlete. 16 nominees this year. We'll talk more about that a little bit later on. Number two, a screening committee from the J Club selects 10 finalists. Number three, the selection committee, the 40 members, as I said, ranks all finalists from 1 to 10, or 10 to 1, technically. The cumulative fan vote accounts for one ballot, and the top four are here tonight in terms of vote getters. It's a mystery. It's a mystery to me. Nobody told me who won here tonight. Pat Coleman, I think, as well. So we have no idea. Like we said in the opening of this show, though, history will be made in some way, shape, or form or another. Yes, 22nd Gagliardi Trophy winner will be awarded or given the award. And it could be a two-time winner. Could be another junior. Only the second time it's happened, and it obviously never happened twice in a row. Or two schools that have not had a Gagliardi Trophy winner in history. We know that they're getting ready up on stage to do the proceedings, to put everything together here, and take you the rest of the way through this. After the award is given out, though, we will have the first interview with the Gagliardi Trophy winner, so you'll want to stay tuned for that. And as well, don't forget, on d3football.com, we'll have an audio broadcast for you of the Stagg Bowl
on Friday night, but also a pregame show scheduled to start around 5 o'clock, a video show, and 6:30, a live audio show as well. So you'll want to tune in for those shows. The Stagg Bowl here is obviously the ultimate in why we are here, but the Gagliardi Trophy over the last, I think, about 5 years when we've done this Final Four process has become much more of an anchor as well to make it a full, let's say, 3 or 4 days of activities down here in Salem, Virginia. I hope that at some point you personally get to come to Salem to enjoy this event and the Stagg Bowl as well. But if you can't, you know that you can always go to d3football.com and get our take on what's happening. I'll be in the sideline, Pat Coleman, Keith McMillan in the booth for us. So I think we are just about set here to send it to the front dais. And again, I'm Frank Rossi here. We'll be back. I will have that interview with the Gagliardi Trophy winner coming up in just a little bit. But first, we'll have interviews with all 4 finalists up on stage and then ultimately the winner. Here we go. Take it away at the dais.
Right here at the Salem Civic Center as we honor Division III's Player of the Year. At this time, to learn a little bit more about the award itself and the man for whom it is named, I'd like to welcome to the podium, if you would give him a big round of applause, from St. John's University, Mr. Jim Gagliardi.
Thanks, Mike. I'll make this real quick. You guys have all been here many times. Maybe some feel too many times, but congratulations, first of all, to both schools. It's outstanding. You are the envy of the rest of Division III, and again, congratulations. You know, everybody thought a couple years ago when Coach Karras, the elder, retired that there might be a little opening in there. Nope. That hasn't been the case. Vince took over and did a great job, and outstanding, and now there's this glimmer of hope up in the Midwest. I'm sure whoever shows up at Whitewater will try to put that glimmer of hope out fast too, but congratulations to both you guys and your teams. Outstanding, again, you are the envy of the rest of Division III, maybe the rest of college football. I don't know how you guys do it year in and year out. It's unbelievable. In fact, before I came up here, I talked to my dad before I came, and you know, he's obviously proud of this award named after him and all, but all he could talk about is, if you know him, he's got a way about it. He just goes, damn it, I just don't know how these guys do it. He says, you know, over and over, it's tough. And I guarantee you the coaches' staffs on both of these teams put in plenty of time and turn these programs into machines. Again, there'll be a quick video here in a second, but I did want to recognize, you know, we have 4 great candidates up here, and they're all 4 outstanding. I had a chance to visit with 3 of them. One of them was pretty busy this week, but I also wanted to also congratulate Whitewater, had a finalist here too, and if Brady could stand up and give him a round of applause. Brady? There he is. Congratulations. I tell you what, and again, I'm going to bring just a quick story from my dad. He asked, well, who are the finalists? And our sports information director, Ryan Klinkner, told him all. He listed off the 4. He says, wasn't there a Whitewater guy on there? And he said, yeah. He says, and he's not one of the 4 finalists? I said, who the hell is voting for this? He wanted to get the list of it. So he figures if Whitewater puts up a guy and they're here every year, you should, you know, at least be up here. And he's probably right. But it certainly doesn't diminish what these 4 guys have done and have accomplished. So without further ado, I guess there's a video here. I'm not sure if it's one from last year that you guys have all seen or one from the previous year. But we'll go with that. Thank you.
Mm. The measure of a man can be defined in his life's work. Excellence is often equated with winning. John Gagliardi won more games than any coach in college football history. 489. He coached for 60 years at St. John's University, a Division III
Benedictine college in Minnesota, where he won 4 national championships. But not all merits are measured by numbers. There is no statistical value for virtue or integrity. In 1953, he came to St. John's, a 26-year-old head coach, a simple man with a simple message.
The only advice I'd say, treat everybody the way you'd like to be treated. I said that to my players over and over, year in and year out.
He taught that football wasn't everything. Football is a stepping stone to something more important. You know, your life, your family, your friends.
That's true. I think that was his philosophy. He didn't expect that you're going to go play in the pros, but he did expect that you're going to be good men.
First day of my freshman year, he took a dime out of his pocket and held it up to the sun. He said, that dime is football and that sun is your education. Don't get them confused. And part of that was the respect for the human being and the whole notion that he was interested in your whole life. And it's because of the value system that the Benedictines have instilled at St. John's. I think the players responded to that.
Just trying to do the right thing. And that's really the only rule I ever had with him, the golden rule.
Gagliardi preached personal accountability. In practice, he eliminated anything deemed unnecessary, an unorthodox approach he called winning with nose.
We didn't have any blocking sleds, no dummies, no whistles, no cows.
Probably the most radical was no tackling in practice. People say, how can you possibly do that? There were so many injuries in practice that it would hurt us in a game time. So all we would work on in practice is defeating the blocking scheme, getting the proper pursuit, all the kind of things mental, you might say.
We were always very well prepared and fundamentally sound, and those are the things that are gonna win a lot of football games.
His principles proved basic yet effective. In 1963, St. John's won its first national championship, and another in 1965. In 1976, Gagliardi won his third. He was revered as a coaching icon, yet to his players, he was still John.
I don't think I've ever heard him, anyone has ever called him coach. You know, I've heard it a couple times, and, he'll just say, no, I'm John.
He was John. He's always been John. From the day one, he's been John. So if you have a question, call him John. We have a lot of guys on our team, 180 or so guys come out for the team. There's only 22 spots for starters. But every one of those kids is made to feel important on the team, and that's one of the legacies that John's left.
He is a community person, and that's really what St. John's is built on, is a community, that spirit. The neighborhood kids would always want him to play, because he'd play with us. And at that time, we're talking early 70s, dads were just that, going to work, bringing home the salaries, and he was all about family time.
Family life and coaching life became one and the same as son Jim joined the team as a player and later as an assistant coach. In 2003, father and son stood side by side to witness history.
Elliott split left, Riegelman to the right side, split back to the backfield. Keating under center, 5-step drop, back to pass, into the flat. Nelson the catch at the 6, to the 5, to the 4, dives, touchdown Johnny's! John Gagliardi's 409th career game, history made here today.
People ask me how it's done. Well, talent, and luck, and prayers. Thanks very much.
The times changed, but the man did not. John Gagliardi held on, and he kept winning.
John Gagliardi
trying to win his fourth national championship in first since 1976. And St. John's eschewing the field goal opportunity. Now the 14th play of this drive. And they swing it out to Tice. Tice needs some blocks downfield. And he gets into the end zone for the touchdown. Burkhart for Knapp, and it's picked off. Intercepted by Mike Sahar. And he is going to go. St. John's pulling off this upset. A 100-yard interception return for the Johnnies. So John Gagliardi, for the fourth time, is a national champion.
It's hard for me to believe I'm married to him. He's done so many things so well.
After 70 years in coaching, John Gagliardi retired. In 2013, at 86 years old, he watched a St. John's game from the stands for the very first time. Yet, John Gagliardi was surrounded by his team.
Oh God, I can't get out of this chair. Let me give you, good to see you.
How you doing, buddy?
Good to see you.
You doing good?
Good to see you. Only the best back we ever had here. Billy, how are you? Nice to see you.
How are you?
John, how are you?
Good to see you.
There were things we didn't realize then that you taught us that are bigger than those things we learned on the field.
That makes me proud that I had touched their lives, hopefully for the best.
John Gagliardi, he leaves the game a coaching legend. And to his players, he will simply be remembered.
I think it's very easy to look at that and say, wow, what a well-produced piece of video. But the bottom line is, it wouldn't have been anything without the subject matter. So when you go back home, tell him on behalf of all us, we don't know how he did it all those years either. It was just a tremendous. You don't get tired of watching that. I don't care how many times you see it. All right, here's the way this is going to work. The fun is about to start. We've got four great finalists here tonight for the Division III Player of the Year Award. And I'm going to call the four names right now. I'm going to have these gentlemen exit stage left of me, go across the front, and have a seat in one of the blue chairs over there, with the exception of our first name to be called. I'm going to have him go ahead and sit up on the main stage. So please give these guys a big rousing welcome as they head to that side of the room. From Illinois College, Michael Bates. From the University of Mount Union, Kevin Burke. From Wesley College, Joe Callahan. And from Willamette University, Dylan Jones, your four finalists for the Gagliardi Award. Also, we're very excited tonight to once again have our interviewer from D3 Football, the executive editor of D3Football.com. If you would, please welcome Mr. Pat Coleman. All right, as Pat gets settled, the way this is going to work, right before the interview takes place with each one of the finalists, we will actually watch a video that will help you get to know this individual much better. And then Pat will even go deeper with some one-on-one questions. So at this time, let's take a look at Michael Bates' video.
Michael Bates, where do you begin with a person like Michael Bates? And he's Michael Bates, where do you begin with a person like Michael Bates? And he's obviously one of the greatest athletes that Illinois College has ever had. I mean, on the field, he's signing records, he's doing all sorts of great things. But what some people may not know is that Michael Bates is a great person. And that's something that I've been able to see over the last few months of being here and being in the hallways and seeing him come through. And he's the type of guy that you want leading a program. He's the type of guy that you want working for you. He's the type of guy that
that you want to be around. He's got that sort of pull you want to be close to a guy like him. Michael is a tremendous person. He's a tremendous athlete. He's a tremendous asset to Illinois College, and he will be forever remembered here at IC as one of the all-time greats.
I'd like to congratulate Michael Bates on being selected as a finalist for the Gagliardi Trophy in Division III. Michael has done an excellent job at Illinois College. We're very, very proud of him. He represents all that we hope for in our students as we prepare them for lives of leadership and service. Michael has an outstanding academic record. He has a GPA of 3.87, and he's studying majors in biology and minor in chemistry. With Michael as quarterback, the Illinois College football program has reached unprecedented heights. He's an excellent leader for our team. In his first year at Illinois College, we made it to the Division III playoffs. And in his senior year, we competed for the Midwest Conference Championship game. Michael is a thoughtful, well-prepared, results-oriented person, shows on and off the field.
So Michael Bates is probably the best man I've ever been associated with in the game of football. I've been around the game my entire life. My dad was a coach. And, I've played and coached, so I've been around it for 40 years. And Michael Bates is by far the best man I've ever been around within the game of football. His dedication to his teammates, his leadership skills, he's got a great left arm and can throw the heck out of the plate and ball, but really what he really stands for as an individual and stands for as a person is everything we want out of our young people, not just the best player, but he was just a special
So, Michael, welcome to Salem.
Thank you. Yep. Thanks for having me.
I know this is not the first big award that you were up for this season, and you've won the other one already. What's it like being the Academic All-American of the Year?
That was probably the best honor that I've had in my time at IC, just because it sort of culminated everybody that's been a part of my journey. I've gotten accolades just on the football field, and that meant a lot because it really went toward. Just all the credit and glory went towards my teammates and coaches, but that was really special because it included everybody, my professors, the administrators at IC, sort of just putting me on a platform just to show my talents to the nation. Yeah, that was really cool, and definitely was very honored and humbled to have that.
Your college president mentioned you were handed the reins of the offense at a very young age. Now, what advice would senior Michael Bates have for that freshman Michael Bates?
I don't know. I think just to enjoy it. If you would have told me what's your prediction for the next 3 years, making to the playoffs freshman year and having a successful year like that, I would have said, winning. That's what I expect these next 3 years. But it was really cool just to figure out that that's not what it was about. It was about the relationships. And while we came up a game short those next 3 years, it was still successful. Just because the people that I got to play with and the relationships that I got to form in my time there.
Yeah, and for those who don't know, the Midwest Conference added some excitement this year. They split into two divisions, played a championship game. You guys, as was mentioned, played in that championship game. And, it may not have turned out as you like, but what was the experience like to have that at the end of the season?
Yeah, that was cool. D3 football is awesome in itself, just what it stands for, the student-athlete part of things. But, yeah, that sort of added to the excitement of it. Definitely for the football part of it, and we came up short, but it was a successful year just because we were able to accomplish a lot of things with a young squad, and injuries happened, and we still overcame those, and it was really fun.
You have a lot of community service on your resume. What projects are most special to you, or what do you most want to talk about?
I think the one probably in my hometown. It was cool to travel to Jamaica and Staten Island and just help out with the relief effort like that, mission trips like that, but just sort of the idea behind Stronghold in my hometown in Auburn, Illinois. It's a small town, but it was just one of those things where if we can do this, you know, around the country and around the the world, why can't we do this right here in our hometown? So just sort of seeing the support that we got from the community for that, and just the yearly support that we get, and we'll continually get for that, is just really cool. And just, you know people that you've grown up with your whole entire life in your hometown, but to really know them, I mean, get to know them and form relationships and help them out, that's just, it was really cool and really honored just to, for them to be able to welcome us into their home to help them out, so yeah.
Who came here with you today?
My wife, Alexandra, did. She's in the red dress, very pretty one. And then my parents, and then my in-laws, and Coach Campbell and Mike Snyder. So yeah, that's really, really, really special.
Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Michael Bates.
And I'd like to give him a round of applause for recognizing his wife before his coach. Smart man right there. Next up, we know a lot about him, but let's get up close and personal with Kevin Burke.
Kevin Burke, quarterback, the University of Mount Union.
Two words jump out to my mind, and you know, one is his poise. He's shown tremendous poise through his time here, and I think that's had a real positive effect on our team. That's a critical attribute for anyone in a leadership role, especially at the quarterback position. And then to his leadership. He's meant so much to our team, both on the field with his ability to make plays as a quarterback, and then also off the field. He's done so many things to cast a positive image of our team. And I think that's, his leadership is just, it's trickled down through our whole football program. He's just had a tremendous impact on our team.
The 2013 Gagliardi Trophy winner is back in Salem, Virginia, looking to become the award's first two-time recipient. In 2014, Burke led the Purple Raiders to their 23rd consecutive Ohio Athletic Conference title while passing for nearly 3,700 yards and 42 scores and adding another 468 yards and 9 touchdowns on the ground. Burke is tied with Marcus Mariota of the Oregon Ducks with a quarterback rating of 186.3, the highest quarterback rating of all players at that position in America.
He is a winner. And no matter what the situation is, when we get in that huddle, if we're down 3, if we're down 7, if we're up by 7, and we know what we have to do, we know Kevin's going to get it done. If it's 3rd and long, we know Kevin's going to get us in the right play, and we're gonna execute. If it's 3rd and short, we know if Kevin is getting pressured, we know he's going to get us the first down. And time in and time out, he gets it done for us.
The two-time All-American led Mount Union to the 2012 National Championship and back to the Amos Alonzo Stagg Bowl last season. During his career in Alliance, Ohio, Kevin Burke has passed for nearly 11,400 yards, 124 touchdowns, while rushing for nearly 2,400 yards and 27 scores en route to becoming a two-time All-American.
Kevin has a great work ethic. He's always, you know, the one that's leading our workouts and taking care of business in the weight room and kind of showing the younger guys what to do. On the field, he takes care of everything. He's always making the calls. He's prepared for the games. He knows what to do in practice, and that kind of carries over to the game. So, you know, his work ethic speaks for itself. I mean, the other day I saw him walking to class, watching film, so that just kind of goes to show you a little bit of his work ethic.
It is off the field, however, where Burke achieves greater heights. Kevin donates much of his time to many different civic and charitable endeavors. Burke packs and distributes meals to needy children as part of Mount Union's Ralph and Mary Regula Center of Public Service. Burke also organizes the Relay for Life, an effort to raise funds for cancer research. The senior signal caller's efforts do not end there. He also spearheaded Be the Match, a bone marrow registry drive in Alliance. Burke has been a regular participant in Trick or Treat with the Raiders during Halloween time and regularly reads to elementary school students as part of the 2nd and 7th Foundation.
Kevin really understands the process that it takes to get this team to the level that it needs to be at each and every year. He understands that it's not just during 15 weeks that you work towards this goal. It's a year-long effort. And it's not just about him, it's about this entire team. So he's always in here. He's committed to getting people where they need to be, no matter what stage of the process they're in. He's committed to bringing freshmen up to speed. He's committed to getting the older guys to their peak levels of ability out on the field. He understands what it takes to make this team a national championship team.
Being loyal to Kevin is probably my favorite part of playing offensive line. If we don't give up a sack, he buys us milkshakes for every offensive lineman. The more loyal he is to us, the more we want to protect him and have him get great stats. Also, you know, Kevin's my best friend, so that's the kind of thing you look for in a friend, is loyalty. A lot of people don't really see the real Kevin Burke, who he's about. I've lived with him for 3.5 years now, and a lot of people see the quarterback, the leader, the captain, but, you know, it's a lot different at home who he really is. You know, he's either dancing in his room or, you know, doing something wild. He's a pretty funny guy.
This past summer, Burke interned with the United States Secret Service Office in Cleveland. Kevin Burke, a member of the Capital One Academic All-American team in 2014, as he carries a 3.37 grade point average, majoring in business administration.
Joe Callahan, 2014 Gagliardi finalist.
By 20, 50, another block,
In 2013, Joe Callahan burst onto the national scene by throwing for 510 yards in his first career start. He ended that season with an NCAA playoff record 633-yard, 8-touchdown performance against Mount Union. With high expectations in 2014, Joe did not disappoint.
This time going deep, he's got a receiver behind the defense, and it's caught to the 5. Touchdown, Wesley!
This season, he threw for an NCAA leading 4,190 yards and a school record 46 touchdowns.
Back to pass. That's a nice pocket going for it all. He's got Steve Caduceo behind the defense. Touchdown, Wesley!
More importantly, his play led to the Wolverines' 10th straight NCAA playoff appearance and their 6th regional championship. His efforts earned him first-team All-South Region honors by D3Football.com.
Touchdown, Wesley, on the bootleg.
Well, we feel, one, it's such a prestigious honor, you know, on our level. It's like the equivalent to the Heisman Trophy for Division I. You know, for us to have a person there, you know, it's just a great pride. You know, and Joe is such a great, not just player, but a great kid. You know, he's an excellent student. You know, he's somebody who always thinks of his teammates before he thinks of anything about himself. You know, he has no idea that he's, you know, second in the country in touchdown passes or any of that stuff. That's all meaningless to him. You know, winning games is what's important to him. Well, you know, Joe's a quiet leader. You know, around us, he's not a real talkative guy. But around his teammates, you know, he's really vocal, you know, and I know his teammates are extremely excited about this.
His success on the field is matched by success off the field. As an exercise science major, Joe has excelled in the classroom with a 3.4 grade point average. He has also played an important role in the college and local community. As a member of the Wolverine Student Athletic Advisory Committee, Joe participates in Wesley's annual food drive for the Food Bank of Delaware, the Read Across America program, as well as the Campus Community Schools program, Cougars for a Cause.
Deep comeback route. Joe steps up in the pocket, shows the velocity of the team from what I've seen on tape, and that's really not typical of their team. And
all right, Joe, so you're the latest in a long line of successful Wesley quarterbacks. I go back and I think of Chris Warwick, Jason Visconti in there for a while. Seemed like Shane McSweeney and Justin Sotelaire kind of shared that job forever. And here you are. You're in your second year as a starter with a year left to go. What's it like, you know, following that long group?
You know, and I think that starts with the coaches. Coach Knapp and Coach Stress have been here through it all, and Coach Knapp's really done a great job with the quarterbacks. All the time that he puts in, it really shows with the quarterback play on the field. I was lucky enough to play with Shane McSweeney and Justin Sotelaire, and they were able to teach me things that you can only learn from experience, like certain ways to read plays or different ways to look at things that maybe Coach Knapp, you know, hasn't told you. But it definitely starts with the coaches, and then the players help each other along the way.
A decade ago, safety Rocky Myers won this award, but you're the first Wesley quarterback to be in this position out of that long list.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely an honor, especially knowing the quarterbacks that have played there in the past and the success that they've had, but, I'm just honored to be here.
Kind of talk us through the strangeness of this year. You start the season with 5 games against Division III opponents, some really good teams there, and then you kind of go on this barnstorming tour where you play 5 more opponents that I don't think played anybody else in Division III all season.
Yeah, well, we're an independent team, so we basically have to play anybody who's willing to play us. Our first 5 games of the season were all Division III games, so we had to win all 5 of those to even make the playoffs. So, those games were critical in our future, and then the last 5 games of the season, we didn't really have a lot of film or like a lot of history playing those teams. So it was difficult for us to game plan, and we were able to try some things on the field, and build momentum working towards the playoffs.
I have to ask you about last week's game. Obviously, not a lot of things went right for you guys against Mountain Union. What do you take away from something like that going into the offseason?
Well, that was definitely a tough game. Wasn't a fun game to really be a part of, but you have to learn from games like that. You know, this is the goal that we have each year, you know, to reach the Stagg Bowl, and, you know, it shows what it takes to get here, and it shows that what we have to do in preparation this offseason to get to that level of play.
Community service-wise, you've been involved in the Ben Knapp 5K Fun Run. Tell us a little bit about that and why it's so important to Wesley.
Well, it's especially important to Wesley because we have a small school and a family atmosphere, and when something happens like that to one of our own, Coach Knapp's son, it's especially important, and I don't ever think it was a question that myself and my teammates would do whatever it takes to help Coach Knapp and his family in whatever way that we can.
Yeah, so Ben is recovering from a traumatic brain injury he suffered a few years ago.
I was there when it happened. We were on an away trip, and in the middle of the night, Ben got sick, and they had to rush him to the hospital, and his heart had stopped for an extended period of time. So, it was a sad situation to be a part of.
You obviously brought some people here tonight. Who's with you tonight?
I'm with my mom, Judy, my dad, Joe, my sister, Susan, my girlfriend, Carolyn, my two coaches, Coach Knapp and Coach Dress, and then our SID, Steve Kramer.
Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Joe Callahan.
And after three quarterbacks, our lone running back of the group, and our final finalist from Willamette, please welcome Dylan Jones.
Already in the record books, tacking on to it, and that just put him over 300 yards.
Hello, I'm Steve Thorsett, the president of Willamette University. I'm delighted to have this opportunity to recognize Dylan Jones, one of our school's all-time greats on the football field, and a man who exemplifies the values of Division III and of the Gagliardi Trophy. In addition to his prowess on the football field and the track, Dylan is first and foremost a successful student of environmental science whose thesis exemplifies Willamette's motto, "Not unto ourselves alone are we born." For all of Willamette, Dylan, we are proud of you. Congratulations to you and to all of the nominees, and go Bearcats.
As far as service goes, you know, Dylan's done a great job for us. He's a four-year guy that gives his time willingly to a bunch of different causes. Most important to our football program recently has been the battle against hunger with the Salem community. Marion Polk Food Share, he does spring and he does fall service with those guys, and like I said, Dylan for us, he's been a leader on the field, off the field, and in the community, and we couldn't ask for a better guy. Congratulations, Dylan. I hope it goes great for you.
It's the bigger the gap.
Jones to the left of the quarterback, Spallis, and gets his first handoff running right. It's a good seal block on the edge, and he's off the races. 50, 45, 40, gone. Dylan Jones, touchdown.
All right, Dylan, welcome to Salem. I know you spent some time in Salem, Oregon, but this is Salem, Virginia, and don't even get me started about those guys in Massachusetts. This is the one you want to be in.
All right.
They talk about rivalries. You know, even if you could have a bad season, you could go winless, but if you beat that arch rival, it's a successful season. And, you know, maybe you guys didn't have the season you hoped, but you guys came out and beat Willamette, beat Willenfield. You had 166 yards rushing, 3 touchdowns. When you look back on this season, you know, in the future, you think it'll be a success in your mind?
I mean, we had some rough losses. But beating Linfield is just one of those things that if you don't beat your rival for 3 years in a row and you go into their house and you beat them, it's just one of those most amazing feelings that a football player can have, I think, or as any athlete. And so for me, I mean, looking back on this, I won't remember the losses. That win against Linfield, 31-28 fouls, I still remember, so.
Yeah, because I know you had a pretty competitive game with them, and then they kind of had your number there for a couple of years.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, my freshman year, we came in and we competed well with them. The next 2 years, I mean, it got out of hand with us. But, I mean, senior year, we did it. Our class did it, so it's a great honor.
What type of running back do you model yourself after? When you sit down on Sundays, who are you watching?
My top backs in the league are guys like Marshawn Lynch, Eddie Lacy, DeMarco Murray. They're just those guys who run with such power and aggression. I mean, they're much bigger guys. They're real strong, and I just love seeing that aggression, that power that they run with, and how much tenacity they have, just the will to not get tackled. As a running back, I think that's what you strive for, and that's what those guys epitomize for me. So
my dad's a research biochemist, and I want no part of that, let me tell you. You're an environmental science major. That's obviously not easy. What's the toughest class you had?
I took a class at a water resources class that really focused on water issues in the West. And for me, that was a class that, I mean, it wasn't a heavy science class. It was more of the laws and the intricacies behind water politics in the West, especially in California. And that was just a class that, I mean, there's so many different variables that go into who gets what water and how much. And I mean, that was just a class that had my number.
For me, I would think trudging around in the swamp would be something I'd want to avoid.
I mean, that's what drew me to environmental science. I love being outdoors. I love being out in nature. I mean, the swampier, I mean, the better for me. I love it.
You've had a really interesting internship with that other city of Salem. I know you don't have all that data in yet, and you don't have to take us through your entire senior thesis, but what are some of the things that you've found out?
So my thesis is looking at how different socioeconomic neighborhoods affect water quality, local water quality. We have a lot of streams in the city of Salem, so just trying to see how those different areas affect the water quality. So.
Well, who came with you tonight? Who'd you bring?
Right here, my beautiful mother, my stepdad Stan, Susan Rodriguez, stepdad Stan, Uncle Arnie, Aunt Sarah, and Coach Fowles.
Ladies and gentlemen, a hand for Dylan Jones. Congratulations.
Pat, I want to thank you very much. Let's give Pat a round of applause for handling our interviews for us tonight. Great job.
Thanks. Thanks.
And Dylan, I'm going to ask you, if you would, with moderate aggression, lead all 4 finalists back to the podium this way, and let's give them a big round of applause as they make their way back to the dais. As they get ready to sit down, I would like to recognize just 3 other people who are here tonight. There really are so many that make this possible, but there are a couple in here tonight that I would like to mention, and I know that Mr. Harvey Cutter, who opened us tonight with the invocation, would want them to be recognized as well. Both our city manager and assistant city manager, Mr. Kevin Boggess and Jay Talaferro, are here. If you would just stand briefly right there. And also a gentleman who certainly understands the feelings of Mount Union Whitewater, and also all 4 of you at the podium here. Our mayor, Randy Foley, is a former Division I player at the University of Virginia. He also has been a high school coach, and he just recently went through probably the most excruciating thing. His son's high school team here in Salem was 14-0 before it lost in the state final. So it's a tough feeling, but great experiences all the way around. And Mayor Foley, thank you very much for everything. At this time, let's bring up Mike Callison from Jostens and find out who wins this thing tonight.
As always, it's a great pleasure to be here representing Jostens and the Gagliardi Trophy. And I'd like to thank the Salem Rotary Club and the J Club for all your hard work in making this one of the premier awards in the country. I also want to let Mount Union and Whitewater know that we have not run out of ring designs for your championship rings. We order purple stones every year now to make sure that we're ready. So we'll be ready for you when whoever wins on Friday. Now, without further ado, the 2014 Gagliardi Trophy recipient, two-time winner, University of Mount Union, Kevin Burke. Congratulations.
First and foremost, I want to thank my family. Wouldn't be where I am today without you guys. Everybody here, Shannon back home, my sister, all my relatives watching it back home. You know, I wish you guys could be here too. And you know, I know most of you are going to come down Friday. So thanks to my family. I love you guys so much. There's nothing I wouldn't do for you. Graham, I love you so much. And then secondly, and definitely is up there in importance, I want to thank my team, my teammates, my coaches. You know, I would not be up here and the person I am without you guys. I want to thank my offensive line. You know, Brooks Jenkins, Mike Frank, Pat Mahoney, Mitch Doherty, Pursuti, and Alex Goff. You guys obviously have done your fair share of duties and have earned your fair share of milkshakes. So thank you guys. Thanks to my, you know, receivers, running backs, everybody that helps me to be the best player that I can be. All my coaches, Coach McNeely, Coach Schuff, Coach Dart, Coach Karras, everybody that's helped me along the way. Thank you guys, and I can't thank you enough. Coach Karras, Larry Karras, thank you. I want to give a special thank you to the trainers, the training staff who work endless amount of time that goes unnoticed to help not only me, but the rest of the players to get where they need to be every single Saturday. Blake and Ryan, thank you guys so much for all your hard work. Thank you to Lenny Reich for putting this, you know, this team in good standing with the media. You know, he works so hard every single day to help us out, and thank you. And also Dean Marini for putting that video together. That was really special. But you know, as far as winning this award, it's such an honor. You know, if you would have asked me 4 years ago what I would have thought of my college career in football, never would have guessed a two-time winner and player of the year. So I'm just so grateful and so humbled. Thank you for everybody that was a part of this, my family especially, again, and go Raiders.
Thank you all so much for being here tonight. The week is just getting started. We've got a great spotlight on Champions Banquet tomorrow night and the game on Friday evening. We hope you will soak in every bit of this. I'm going to ask Kevin and Mr. Callison, if they would, along with Coach Karras, if you guys would go to this stage, and all the media who are here who would like photographs will stage whatever you want until you get everything you need. Thank each and every one of you for being here, and travel safely going home. Take care.
Well, history has been made. We set it in the open, and we didn't know exactly what history would be, but it's one that is truly special. Kevin Burke, two-time winner of the Gagliardi Trophy 2013 and 2014. Right next to me, you see an empty chair. It will be filled very soon by Kevin Burke for his... normally I say first interview as a Gagliardi Trophy winner, but I guess that's actually not true. It'll be his first interview as a two-time Gagliardi Trophy winner, if we're going to be specific about this at this point. And a well-deserved award by somebody who just epitomizes, as we said, not just football player, but a special man, a leader, and somebody who's just gained maturity year and year and year in and out from everybody that we've spoken to throughout the last couple of years especially. You can see that definitely some football video here of him, though. And he's got one more game before he graduates off, and that will be the Stagg Bowl on Friday night here in Salem, Virginia. It's going to be a tussle. It's kind of a revenge game for him after a tough game last season. We'll ask him about that a little bit when he comes up to talk to us. But for now, I believe 43-1 as a starter at Mount Union is an incredible feat, to say the least. That team has played a total of 44 games in the last 3 years, so that means that he was a starter sophomore year, junior year, senior year in every game. The 45th game is the Stagg Bowl on Friday night. 15 games a season is the maximum you can play in Division III, and Kevin Burke will have done that for three straight years after Friday night. So again, Kevin Burke here is our Gagliardi Trophy winner for 2014, just like in 2013. This is not a repeat, and if you're watching this on YouTube, don't worry. You don't have to look back at the title. Make sure you're watching the right one. This is a 2014 presentation, and he has made history. Let me go through. We talked about Archie Griffin from Ohio State in 1974 and 1975 being the two-time winner of the Heisman Trophy. There are other, let's say, divisional trophies given, and in case you're wondering about two-time winners of the most major of the trophies in each division, in FCS, Division I FCS, you have the Walter Payton Award for offense. Armonte Edwards from Appalachian State, won that in 2008-2009. Buck Buchanan Award for defense in FCS went to Dexter Coakley, App State also, from 1995-1996. And in Division II, the Harlan Hill Trophy has been won multiple times by three players. Johnny Bailey from Texas A&I in 1987, 88, 89. Dusty Bonner from Valdosta State in 2000 and 2001. And a player I think that some pro football watchers can remember, Danny Woodhead from Chadron State in 2006-2007. So all told now, that is seven multi-award winners in the most major divisional award in each case. That's seven total, but only one other one from the state of Ohio, Archie Griffin, the Heisman Trophy in 1974-75 from Ohio State. You see Coach Karras with Kevin Burke right now posing with the Gagliardi Trophy, his second. And you heard during the interview with Pat Coleman about the absolute weight of that award. It is probably about 70 pounds, we've heard in the past. And he'll have another one. They'll have to reinforce the floor of the room that they put those in, perhaps, if with all the other hardware I'm sure he's collected as time is going on as well. There you can see again, 2013-2014 Gagliardi Trophy winner, All North Regional Offensive Player of the Year, 43-1 career record at Mount Union, three Stagg Bowls, first time that's happened for a quarterback to start those three, major in business administration, 3.37 GPA, volunteers with Fellowship of Christian Athletes, Mount Union's Relay for Life, and read to elementary children with Second and Seven Foundation. That's just a couple of many things he does. All we could fit on the page, basically, but he's got a lot more where that came from. Trick-or-treat fundraiser event, church activities, high school activities as well. He's done a lot, not just at Mount Union, but in the surrounding community as well, and that's what makes him really glow when you look at his resume. All four finalists, though, we want to congratulate. And, you know, again, they did a great job. I want to pay special attention to the other six semifinalists. You know about the four finalists, obviously. They gave a little attention earlier to Brady Graybold, who's here from Wisconsin Whitewater, senior cornerback. Dominique Hayden, Thomas More College, he's a senior running back. Matt Pulowski, Guilford College junior quarterback. Logan Schrader, Warburg College junior quarterback. And Sam Sura, St. John's University junior running back, and Josh Warbington, East Texas Baptist College junior quarterback. A lot of juniors that didn't make it all the way to the finalist round. They've now called the final 10 the semifinalists, as some were expecting to happen. There used to be two levels of finalists. Now it's semifinalists for the final 10 and finalists for the final four. But one note I want to kind of put out there, kind of a statement. There were 16 schools that nominated players for this award this year, and out of 244 teams in Division III, we know that there are more students deserving of at least accolade of semifinalist, finalist, nominee even. It does create quite a buzz in a school to have a Gagliardi Trophy semifinalist and finalist. My school, Union College, has had a couple over the last decade. And let me tell you, to the sports information directors, athletics directors, college presidents that may be watching this, or friends and family of players that you think could be eligible because of the breadth of resume, make sure your players get nominated. This is such an important, incredible award, and you don't have to win it to get the excitement and the honor. Just being a finalist or a semifinalist or a nominee, like I said, is as important out there to put your school on the map, to put the player on the map, to really show off the specialness of the student athletes that you possess out there. So 16 should be an absolute minimum that we see each year. We'll hopefully we get to see a lot more nominations down the line. Not to take anything away from Kevin Burke, because he probably would have won this award if 160 players were nominated across the country. He's that special in his resume, as we've said many times. Kevin will be joining me in a moment for our second interview in as many years following the Gagliardi Trophy presentation. I think that we're pushing him in this direction as we speak. And again, he'll be right here in mere moments here on the Gagliardi Trophy presentation show, so stay tuned with us here. Again, I'm Frank Rossi, Patrick Coleman, walking him up, I think, literally as we speak, to talk with me here. 5 o'clock, don't forget, d3football.com. We'll have the Stagg Bowl pregame show. 6:30, we'll go to live audio. I'll be on the field while Pat Coleman and also Keith McMillan will bring you play-by-play and color commentary on our audio broadcast. If you can't watch ESPN for some reason, or ESPNU, excuse me, or if you want to have an alternative audio on the background of the video, you know where to tune in. D3football.com will be great for that. So again, only 7 times in all divisions have we had multiple winners, or multiple award winners of the most major awards in each level. And Kevin Burke is that 7th one now here, 2013 and 2014. Gagliardi Trophy winner. And should be coming up here in mere moments. I know people are excited to hear from Kevin at this point. So let us welcome to our platform for the second straight year, my friend, have a seat. I feel like we've done this before, and for good reason. Congratulations to you on being a second time Gagliardi Trophy winner. It's history, my friend. Bring that right up to your mouth and tell folks what you're feeling right now. Which one was tougher for you to endure, last year's or this year's? Because you didn't seem that stressed out about it last year. Right now you feel maybe a little more relief, it seems like. Now let's talk about something. I watched that Wesley game last weekend. You played like a man possessed, as if there was a demon you needed to exorcise from last year. You played like a man with some demons to exorcise from last year. Okay. The 62-59 game, obviously, was closer than people wanted to see. Seemed like you wanted to make sure that door was shut on Wesley right from the start, no matter what, all through that game. Now you have one more situation that you might want to rectify in the Stagg Bowl coming up. The loss last year was your first starting loss since you were 13 years old.
Right.
I think, if I remember correctly. What did you learn from that, and how has it carried you through the season this year?
Well, I learned a lot from it. That you know, putting in the hard work is not enough to just get to that point, get to where you want to go in the Stagg Bowl. It's, you have to put in the extra work to finish what you want to do and what you started. So, learned a lot from essentially getting embarrassed on national TV. It was tough, very tough. And like you said, you know, I haven't had to deal with that, you know, thankfully, many times before in my life. But it was a tough loss for me and, you know, the rest of our team. So, you know, just learned a lot from it. We're more motivated now than I think I've ever had, you know, in my entire life with a team. So, you know, like I said, we're just more than excited to get out there on Friday and do this.
Pat asked you about football and the possibilities of playing football after graduation or being involved with football in some way, shape, or form.
beyond football, what else is there for you coming up after graduation? I know you got one more game to look forward to, but right. What can we think about, let's say, public citizen Kevin Burke after graduation? What are you hoping to do?
You know, I have nothing set in stone right now. There's options, and you know, whatever Kevin Burke gets into after graduation is going to be his commitment for the time being. So, you know, I really don't know. You know, I'm a business management major. So obviously I would like to go into business, and criminal justice is something I have an interest in, obviously, with the internship. And, you know, whatever I choose to go into, I'm just going to give it my all, just like I do for football.
Grandma showing up for tonight. Tell us how that all rose.
It was a surprise. You know, I didn't know she was coming. Didn't know she was going to be here tonight. I knew she'd be here for the game. And, man, I didn't know she was coming. So when I saw her at the hotel, it was overwhelming joy. And you know, she's a big part of who I am today and who my family is today. And, you know, she lost her husband, you know, a couple months ago. And it was tough for her and the whole family. So just seeing her here and having her witness what just happened is makes me more proud and more happy than any trophy could ever bring.
I was going through the stats earlier. There are major awards in FBS, obviously Heisman Trophy, FCS. There are two awards, one for offense and defense at Division II award. You are the seventh repeat winner of the most major award in the divisions, okay. But only one other one in the state of Ohio, Archie Griffin, Ohio State. How does it feel to be up in that echelon as a kind of a trivia question answer at this point of some sort?
Yeah, you know, considering me with Archie Griffin, I think it, in my mind, is outrageous. And Archie is a phenomenal college athlete, and you know, he's obviously etched his place in history. So to consider me with him is crazy to me, but to even be asked that question is something that obviously I've done something right up until this point in my life, and I'm very proud of what I've accomplished.
You have your, from 2 years ago, your championship ring on.
Right.
You got room on this hand?
I got plenty of room on this hand, so hopefully we can get the job done.
I'm going to let you move into that mode at this point. Congratulations on the repeat win. Good luck on Friday, and thanks for joining me again on this interview. I was saying earlier, we used to say the first interview with the Gagliardi winner, but this is my second interview, yeah. First for a two-time winner.
That's right. All righty, thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Folks, again, we want you to stay tuned throughout the week for more stuff here. D3Football.com will have a lot of columns, and we'll have a lot more on Friday as well. The pregame show will begin 5 o'clock, audio at 6:30 live, and kickoff 7 o'clock or thereabouts. ESPN, you will carry the game live video-wise. We'll have the audio broadcast, and you can always go to us and them simultaneously, so don't feel afraid to do so. Pat Coleman, Keith McMillan up in the booth. I'll be on the field. We're going to try to make it a little more interactive as well this year, so stay tuned for that. If you got questions for us while we're calling the game or on the field, we're going to try to make you a part of our broadcast this year, give you a little value-added nature to our audio broadcast. But, again, this has been a phenomenal night. We are all part of history here. The first two-time winner of the Gagliardi Trophy, Kevin Burke, 2013 and 2014 now. And we'll see what happens with that Stagg Bowl, but he'll always be that answer to a trivia question now. We know that much. And his house will have a lot more hardware in it starting when they ship that award back to him. Again, Kevin Burke, champion. Thanks for joining us tonight, folks. And again, we want to thank everybody here, especially our executive producer, Dave McHugh, and the J Club, Old Dominion Athletic Conference, and as well the city of Salem. They have been such great hosts of this event as always. And I want to thank Pat Coleman, D3Football.com, joining me earlier. And the NCAA. How could we forget the NCAA? Somebody is flashing that to me. That's a great point. The NCAA, great supporters of this event. And throughout the week, obviously, a lot more events coming up. So, again, folks, thank you for joining us. And we'll see you on Friday night under the lights at the Stagg Bowl.